And then just to look at another big toxic, which is methyl mercury, not the same nanthimerosal, so that's the mercury that we get when we eat like large fish, tuna, or that sort of things. And the CHARGE study, which is led by Irva Hertz-Picciotto at the Mind Institute, she published this data on children with autism. It's a population-based series of autism cases with match with typical children and developmentally delayed children, and they measured mercury blood concentration with up-to-date techniques, and they also collected a number of data about what these children were eating in terms of fish consumption, what did they have in terms of amalgams in their teeth, were they grinding their teeth, and they showed that after controlling for all these factors, in fact, there was no difference between the children with autism or the controls. They were all at the same levels in terms of mercury in the blood, and that these levels were all comparable to population norms. So again, something which does not suggest that this idea that there would be a mercury poisoning in autism is not really born supported by this data. Of course, as they argued, this is happening like years after the diagnosis, and therefore it doesn't rule out that mercury at an earlier stage, earlier age, could play a role in the etiology. But that's a different story for a different design. Now, let's talk about infectious agents. Quickly, there are a number of prenatal infections which have been in the literature, many, many small case series, reports not consistent, very few case control studies well done, with inconsistent results mostly. The only thing which is, again, a proof of concept is the congenital rubella. You probably recall that there was an epidemic in 63-64 in the U.S. Large number, like dozens of thousands of children were born with congenital rubella. And Stella Chess in 1971 started to document that a high proportion of these children with congenital rubella actually had autistic syndromes. And when she followed them up later, she actually documented that many of them were improving, particularly socially, in a way which was not typical of typical childhood autism. So there was an idea that the phenotype and the trajectories were slightly different. Now, it's historical because, in fact, we don't see congenital rubella anymore, or very rarely. There are some cases of postnatal infections, but they are really sparse and difficult to assess. With the exception of this report by Susan Folstein, following an expedition in Tanzania where she investigated a number of children in the schools and then argued that there was like at least three cases out of 14 where she had unambiguous typical development before the onset of malaria, often with a cerebral form of malaria, at least involving high fever convulsions, and then the children developed autistic symptoms after this malaria episode. It has not been replicated since then. It was all based on retrospective accounts by parents. There was no corroborative evidence independent of the parental reports. And I think unless we have a replication, some kind of study which I will not really consider as difficult. Now, people have also looked at season of birth. You may not know, but there is a tradition of looking at season of birth in various psychiatric disorders. It has been done particularly with schizophrenia, where people have looked at patterns of birth in the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere to look at whether it's the same as controls or not. And the idea was to identify increase in rates of birth of particular people with the conditions so that it could be mapped on to particularly epidemics of different infectious agents. So for instance, we know flu have a particular pattern, and if there is a connection being exposed to the flu during pregnancy, for instance, we should see a spike of birth occurring for schizophrenic birth, for instance, if following a particular flu epidemic. That's been done in multiple studies, including in autism and measles. But this the studies have been so far very inconsistent. So after a few studies, every month of the year was incriminated as being the culprit. There has been no replication easy to obtain. But surprisingly, more recently, this study by Lee again comes back with an examination of the same question, and they found something which is very, this is a modeling of the data where they try to argue that it's not statistically significant, that there is an increase in April, July, of October of birth of later to be diagnosed autistic children. But when they did like what it's called Poisson regression, they actually didn't find really significant results. So it's again more tentative than conclusive. And there is a more recent study in ALSPAC in the UK where they also they have very limited power, also try to look at inequality of quarters of birth during the year. I think it's not, the story so far doesn't really pan out as being very interesting, but it's something to be following. Now, in terms of pregnancy, pregnancy risk factors, there's been a long story which I will not review today, where for the last 30 years, when people looking at a range of risk or events occurring during pregnancy, like bleeding during the second trimester, C-sections at birth, and the complications in the neonatal period, a number of untoward events were occurring in children pregnancies when they were later diagnosed with autism compared to controls. The problem was that the magnitude of this association was small, not exceeding risks of 2, which are not very so exciting for epidemiologists. And then the problem was to interpret them, because how do you actually make a sort of unified explanation of something which involves bleeding during the pregnancy, something happening at birth which is minor? There is no common unifying feature for a pathophysiological mechanism. So that was a problem with these findings. And the last point is that people have questioned the direction of this association. We know that pregnancies of children with Down syndrome or pregnancies of children with fragile X have more than their share of complications during the pregnancy and at birth. And it could therefore be that, in fact, the slight increase of these problems in autistic pregnancies is a reflection of the autistic fetus being a cause of this of the problems rather than a consequence. Now, there is much, much more interest now over the last few years into a group of children who are born with extreme low birth weight. And we are talking here about children who are born under 26 weeks of gestational age, so very, very, very severe preemies, with birth weights which are less than 1,500 grams, but now less than 1,000 grams. And, you know, this is due to the progress of medicine, but people have been concerned about the developmental outcomes of these children. And then Catherine Limperopoulos, who worked at Harvard for some time, published 2 years ago somewhat provocative studies where she looked at 91 preterm infants, which you see their mean birth weight is 890 grams at 26 weeks of gestational age, and she followed them at 22 months of age. She administered the MCHAT, which to screen for autistic symptoms, and found that a quarter of them had actually elevated scores and autistic-like symptoms. So, and not only that, but the MCHAT scores were related to lower birth weight, abnormal MRI findings, and social and communication deficits. So that was a very interesting new study. And then she actually published recently another review, which where her study initially is here. But you could see that there are other studies showing the same thing, and including that one by Kuban, which has a sample size of almost 1,000, same type of children, screened at 24 months of age, with about the same figure, 22% of children with MCHAT score, which are positive for screening for autism. So that's really, and that actually follows my clinical practice, because I work in a pediatric hospital and I've been referred more recently a number of children followed by a neonatologist who follow them up, and then they have like multiple developmental delays, and they often refer to me late, 3, 4, and a number of them are typically ASDs. So it rings a bell for me in my clinical work. And then more, just now, the study was done in the UK by the group of Chris Hollis and others, where they basically looked at survivors of children who were born only in 1995 with under 26 weeks of gestational age. And they reviewed them at age 11. And to make the story short, 8% earned a full diagnosis of ASD. So that's the first study which looked at age 11, formal clinical diagnosis of ASD, that occurs in 8% of these children. There might be more children with autistic feature or sub-threshold presentations, but that clearly shows that we need to have a concern, and that it creates an interesting question as what kind of brain events are happening which lead to this experiential ASD. Concerns were raised about ultrasounds. You know, people have, maybe it's because we do too many ultrasounds in pregnancies. In fact, that stemmed with animal studies initially, but then there's been like no confirmation in a more recent case control study showing that between ASD and control, there is no more frequent ultrasounds, or the timing of the ultrasounds is not different. So, not something to pursue. Now, there is more concern now about the increasing use of assisted reproductive technologies, in vitro fertilizations and other techniques, that we know in the animals that it could actually affect some methylation patterns and dysregulate some genes. There is some suggestion that in humans, there are two syndromes which are imprinted disorders, which are raised in frequency, although the base rate is low, in children who have been born through ARTs. Now, in terms of, can we say that it applies to autism? No, at this point in time, although there are some studies in progress or being not published which indicate such an association. This is, I'm showing you here, a meta-analysis by a group of Scandinavians, essentially, where they looked at CP, which is cerebral palsy, where, yes, there is an increased risk of CP and preterm delivery following ART, but for ASD, and this is their table where they reviewed all the studies published, you can see that there is no convincing increase in the risk of ASD in this particular review. But it's something to be pursued, because clearly there are genetic effects of these techniques which may be relevant for us at a later point.